Welcome back to Simplifying Synthesis, the channel where we look at complex organic chemistry and explain how it works. Today, we are going to look at the asymmetric total synthesis of spirochensilide A, which was published by the Yang group. This synthesis is quite long and very challenging, and the group has published two further papers on the methodology developed, which I highly recommend checking out. Spirochensilide A is a member of an emerging and biologically important class of natural products, with a unique spirocyclic core, which was isolated by Gao and co-workers from the Abies chensiensis plant, which is an evergreen fir native to China. Extracts from this plant have shown a range of biological activities, including anti-tumor, antimicrobial, anti-ulcerogenic, anti-inflammatory, antihypertensive, antitussive, and CNS modulating activities. The compound which we will be looking at has shown a moderate effect on inhibiting NO production, which suggests that it could be useful in inflammatory diseases. Structurally, this compound is quite unusual and challenging, as it bears two pairs of vicinal all-carbon quaternary centers, an unusual spirocyclic ring system, and an anomeric spiroketal. All of these features present significant challenge, which makes this total synthesis all the more noteworthy. So let's look at the retrosynthesis and how the authors planned to overcome this challenge. The authors planned to use an oxidative cyclization to install the spiroketal motif. The precursor to this reaction could be generated from a tetracyclic intermediate using aldol chemistry. A Poisson-Cand reaction could be used to generate this intermediate from a bicyclic enine precursor. This could be generated from alkylation of an aldehyde, which in turn could be produced using a semi-pinacol rearrangement. A Sano-Gushira coupling could be used to introduce the alkyne, and the precursor to this would be generated from a concerted cyclization of a geraniol derivative. So with the retrosynthesis covered, let's look at the forward synthesis. The synthesis started with a Lewis acid-promoted cyclization using titanium tetrachloride. This reacts with the dibromomethane solvent to generate titanium tetrabromide. Coordination of the Lewis acid to the epoxide oxygen increases the electrophilicity and allows nucleophilic attack by the alkene, which in turn is attacked by the alkyne. This cyclization is very similar to the radical cyclization which we saw in the synthesis of leonucatal. The cation, which is generated by this cyclization, is attacked by the bromide ion to generate the brominated product. The bromide product is generated in preference to the chloride due to the increased nucleophilicity of bromide relative to chloride, and more importantly, the excess of bromide, which was used as a solvent, when compared to the chloride, which was used as a catalyst. Only one isomer was formed in this reaction, and we can explain this by looking at the transition state. The two carbon-carbon bonds which are formed happen through a concerted mechanism, and this occurs in the lowest energy conformation, which is a chair-like transition state for both of the newly formed rings. In this conformation, the reacting orbitals can overlap and form the desired bonds. With the vinyl bromide in hand, the authors then progressed to a Sano-Gushira coupling to install the alkyne. This starts with a palladium zero catalyst, which undergoes oxidative addition into the carbon-bromine bond. This then undergoes transmethylation with a copper alkyne complex, which is generated by the reaction of copper iodide and the alkyne precursor in the presence of base. This transmethylation process generates a palladium complex, which upon reductive elimination produces the desired alkynylated product. Taking this forward, the hydroxyl group was first protected with TBS chloride, and then the alkene was epoxidized using MCPBA in a prelysave reaction. This epoxidation reaction was stereoselective. Steric hindrance from the methyl group directed the peroxy acid to the bottom face of the ring to generate an anti-orientation between the methyl group and the epoxide. The epoxide was then reacted in a semi-pinnacle rearrangement. Activation of the oxygen with boron trifluoride triggered a rearrangement reaction in which the epoxide ring opens to generate a cation, and then migration of an alkyl group completes a ring contraction reaction from a six-membered ring to a five-membered ring, and upon workup reveals an aldehyde in place of the epoxide. This reaction was stereospecific and only generated a single diastereomer. This reaction works by the thermodynamic drive to stabilize the positive charge generated by the opening of the epoxide ring. By the migration of a carbon-carbon bond in the same plane as the empty orbital, it allows the empty orbital to end up adjacent to the oxygen atom, which is best suited to stabilize it due to its electron density. As this happened through a 1-2 alkyl shift, the stereochemistry was retained, as the bond migration process does not allow for any free rotation of the intermediate. With the alkyne now installed, the authors could functionalize the molecule with the other precursor necessary for the Poisson-Kahn reaction. For this, they used a cyclopropene moiety, which will accelerate the reaction due to its inherent strain. Addition of an alkyl organolithium compound to the aldehyde generated the desired product in a single isomer, which was then protected using a TES group. To explain this selectivity, we can use the Felkin-Ahn model of nucleophilic addition to carbonyl centers. For this reaction to occur, the nucleophile must approach the electrophile from the Burgi-Dunitz angle of 107 degrees. This approach maximizes the overlap of the HOMO of the nucleophile and the LUMO of the electrophile while minimizing electrostatic repulsion. If this kind of analysis is new to you, watch the video on Baldwin's rules where I explain this model in detail. So let's look at the possible orientations of this reaction and explain why only one isomer was generated. The terms C and Re are used to describe faces of a prochiral sp2 hybridized center. A nucleophile adding to the Re face will generate one isomer, while if it adds from the C face of the electrophile, it will produce the other. Looking at the Newman projection, we can see that when a staggered conformation is adopted with the oxygen orientated away from the ring, the nucleophile cannot approach the reacting LUMO from either direction due to steric hindrance from the ring. However, if the oxygen is orientated over the ring and a staggered conformation is adopted, the nucleophile may approach from the Re face of the electrophile. Meanwhile, the C approach is still blocked by steric hindrance. As only one approach is favorable, this explains why only one product was generated, as this reaction was carried out at very low temperatures to ensure selectivity. With both the alkene and the alkyne now installed, the authors turned their attention to the Poisson-Kahn reaction, a key step in this synthesis. After extensive screening of catalysts and revision of their initial intended intermediate, the authors arrived at using trisacetonitrile tricarbonyl tungsten as the catalyst. This reacts with the alkene and the alkyne of the molecule and inserts a carbonyl center, overall forming a five-membered enone ring. The cyclopropene moiety was essential to the success of this reaction, as the high strain present within this ring accelerates the reaction and drives it forward. This reaction was unselective and produced a racemic mixture of isomers. So let's look at the mechanism. The acetonitrile ligands on the tungsten complex are quite labile and are easily exchanged, which allows the tungsten to coordinate to both the alkene and the alkyne in a pi fashion. Oxidative addition forms one of the carbon-carbon bonds and leaves the tungsten complex still coordinated to both carbon groups. A migratory insertion then occurs, which was promoted by the presence of carbon monoxide, which was delivered using a balloon of the gas to provide the atmosphere necessary without excess pressure. The migratory insertion forms a new carbon-carbon bond, this time between the carbon of the alkyne and the carbon monoxide ligand on the tungsten complex. Reductive elimination completes the sequence and produces the five-membered enone together with the regeneration of the tungsten catalyst. That brings us to the end of this video. If you enjoy this content, please like and subscribe. And if you have anything you'd like me to cover, let me know in the comments down below. I'll be back again next week, where we will be looking at the next part of this synthesis.